Welcome to Xbox Uncut's weekly podcast, and we're back for episode 158 with the amazing cast. I was going to use another word, but amazing cast. We have the wonderful Tim Dog on the show today. Welcome to the show, Tim.
How you guys doing? Pleasure to be here. Friday night, let's get going, talking games.
That's terrible. All right, if you haven't heard, we have interactive buttons on Beam. I'm so excited. I was trying to find something, and if as long as it doesn't get spammed, we'll leave them up. But we're going to have interactive audio during Beam now. So if you're watching live, you can sit there. You can actually interact with the show directly and let us know when it's time to move on, if we just need more Tim, or, you know, what's going to happen next. And don't trust me, I will ban that boo button. Just saying. That's 600 points per boo. You'll lose all your points very quickly.
Unless Mike Yarbar comes in here and he's level 80, and he could probably spam it through the whole show.
Yeah, he probably could. It's supposed to be like a 70-second cooldown timer on it. I don't know why it's allowing people, why it's going so by so quickly. I might need to go in there and edit that later to see what's going on with it. But back to the point of the show. Let's get back to, welcome to the show, Jason.
Yeah, I'm here.
And then exciting. We also have Will. Welcome to the show, Will.
Hey, thank you. Welcome. Thank you for having me back. You know, it's been a real pleasure hanging out with you guys. And as always, Steve rules, Steve cares, Steve knows.
Yeah, he does. He does, without a doubt. Steve is the man. But
I love Steve.
We all miss him. This is going to either get really annoying. This is either a really good idea or a really bad idea. I don't know yet, but this is we're trying it. We're trying it. All right. I forgot. I need to put this in studio mode. That's right, because I found a trick the other day for my end, not for everybody listening. I'm sorry. This is podcast stuff. But let's get right into the news. Let's talk about the Xbox One S new Battlefield 1 bundle. It's coming. Looks gorgeous. It's a green console, like an army green. Like, are y'all tempted? Huh? Anybody here? No? Maybe? A little bit?
I'm tempted, but that would mean I'd have to give up the gears, so.
I know. Yeah.
So, but I'm tempted just because I would, the military green, I really like.
Yeah, I like the color.
And I don't know. I would consider it if I'd save $149 essentially, you know.
Yeah, green looks pretty sweet. I still have the Gears bundle on pre-order on Amazon, just in case I want to, like, you know, hit that, you know, buy button, because I don't really have any what do you call it, intention to buy it, because I'm waiting for Scorpio, but it's just like just in case, you know. But yeah, the green looks pretty sweet. I actually like the gray one a lot more. It looks a lot closer to the original Xbox One coloring, which is, and I always wanted to see the One S with the darker color scheme, which is, it's pretty sweet.
All right, let's see what, I think I had some specs written down, or no, that's totally, I hit this backwards. But yeah, the Battlefield 1 bundle looks pretty awesome. Nice looking console. I think it's coming, what is it, $399 is the price on that one? Or no, $299.
Which one's $299?
Yeah.
The white one, right?
Yes, yes.
The military green is $349, correct?
Yes, that's it.
That's just the terabyte one, or that's the, 500 gigs.
Well, I think they're all terabyte, or no, they're both 500 gigs. Yeah, they're both 500 gigs.
I see. Yeah, I think they should come with terabyte stuff now, like the terabyte like models instead of the 500, because that's obviously not going to be enough for any of these games, because it's like you're going to have to definitely buy an external for all this stuff.
Yeah,
mine is already filling up. It's like 2 gigs. It's almost pretty much full. But it has a benefit of having, you know, the 500 gigs already there, so you kind of have a little bit of a buffer.
I'm sorry. Yeah, my notes were a little mixed up. That's why I was trying to figure out what was going on. I mixed up the stories accidentally. But let's move on to the next topic, which is... I can hit transition. Drive to music you love in Forza Horizon 3 with Groove. So if you haven't tried Horizon 3 yet, Forza Horizon 3, you'll see that when you get to... You get to purchase, like, radio stations, which is really interesting in this game. So you get... I think it's, like, 2 free unlocks right off the bat. But one on the bottom right says Groove Music. So you're going to be able to actually play your playlist through Groove Music, which is, I think, fantastic.
I wouldn't use the word purchase just so people don't... Because someone's going to get confused and think you actually have to buy it. It's you sign them to the festival. Yeah,
you're signing them to the festival. So you're using in-game credits to purchase.
I'm guessing as you... I don't know. Did they... In the demo, you did that, but... I guess in the full game, there's going to be that element to it, but I wonder if there's going to be quicker access to background music or Groove, or I can't think they're going to make you wait very long to get access to your own music.
Yeah.
Like, I could see, like, locking some of the radio stations back because it's kind of like a progressive thing. Hey, you want this music, you got to unlock it. But at least, hey, at least unlockables are kind of coming back to gaming a little.
Yeah, it's a great feature. I like the they finally kind of integrating more of their other services into the games, which is pretty awesome. I mean, I don't use Groove. It's a great option because you know you can always stream your all this stuff that you have favorited. But you know, for me, I love the Horizon soundtrack already. It's so good. Like when I played it from the demo, it's I don't know if I even want to use the Groove app. I think I'm just gonna like stick with the in-game soundtrack, which is so good.
Yeah, they're gonna have more radio stations too, supposedly. So,
just to read this real quick, Forza Horizon 3's original soundtrack features a broader musical selection than any other Horizon game before, with nearly 150 songs across 8 in-game radio stations, on top of returning favorites like Horizon Pulse and Horizon Bass Arena. Several new stations add new and classic hits from genres across hip-hop, indie rock, punk metal, and of course, classical music. There's even more in Forza Horizon 3's music experience than a sweet soundtrack now. For the first time ever, you can rock music you choose as you drive the Horizon with a Groove Music Pass on Xbox One and PC.
You can also use your OneDrive. And if you have Windows T, if you have Windows 10, if you open your file browser, you'll see something that says OneDrive. You just dump your audio files into there, and they will be accessible in your game. So it's extremely easy.
Sorry, James. No, I just feel like that's kind of... I still don't not have a handle on that particular... I mean, it seems easy, but I'm not 100% sure if I'm going to be doing that, because it seems like it's a little cumbersome on my end, because I don't know if all the files would be correctly put in there and all that stuff. So I'm a little hesitant about that, just as far as just like implementation goes. So hopefully it's easier for me and all the other players to just, you know, put their music in there and make it easier.
Well, if you already have OneDrive set up with like your music and everything, you don't have to go through that method. You can... If you already have your music app on your PC pointed towards your music library and set it up to do all that, you don't have to use that method of just dumping in a OneDrive folder. You can already have everything already sorted. So it's not forcing you into one way of doing it, I guess is what I'm saying.
Oh, that's great then. That's cool.
If you're the kind of guy that doesn't have any kind of music collection, but you want to just have a song in the game, you could just dump it in the OneDrive folder and just go. Like, that's, I think, really what it just is for those kinds of people.
Oh, excellent. Option is definitely better for everyone. More options.
All right, to stay in the Forza news, Forza Motorsport 6 Apex comes out of beta with wheel support. So
that happened weeks ago.
I know. It's just a bunch of racing wheels. Go enjoy it. There's not a lot of news this week, so I was just hitting the Xbox Wire stuff, to be honest. Trying to cover as much.
Is Apex still like a light version of Forza 6, or it's going to be like more feature-rich?
It's a light version of Forza 6, and they'll release Forza 7 as a full-featured version.
Huh. Cool. Well, I mean, PC players enjoy the game. You know, I know you guys have been kind of starting for a really good simulation. It's one of the best sim racer you'll ever find, like, so far. You know, GT is still, like, in the back burner, so, you know, Gran Turismo, that's what I'm referring to. But, yeah, man, PC guys, enjoy it. It's great. Have fun, and come join us.
Yeah, definitely. And, I mean, like, the crossplay's gonna be awesome, so can't wait to see.
Recent news that did come out this week as far as that is, I don't know where the source was, but Microsoft came out and said they are indeed, like, they're not leaving it as is with whale support once Horizon 3 launches. They're actually going to continue to improve the features and compatibility. Yeah. Like, they're not just going to dump it and go, fuck you guys.
Buy this.
What's that?
They're not going to dump it and say, buy this new version. They're going to support
yeah.
it.
Yeah. Well, they're not going to go, here's Horizon 3, you get everything that you see, and then maybe we'll add more the next title. Like, they actually came out and said, no, we're actually going to continue updating it and getting more stuff to work. So, if you have a will that doesn't currently work, there might be a chance in the future that it will work.
Yes. But, to move on, Resident Evil 7 will support HDR on the Xbox One S. So all those
same will Battlefield 1.
Yeah, Battlefield 1 nice. Is also getting a patch, yeah.
And what was the other game? There's a few other games, too. NBA 2K.
Yeah, somebody hit it. I'm a bum. We know. Maybe you're right. Maybe I ain't got it no more. You can't beat Rocky. But so, Resident can't Evil 7, Battlefield, voice. And a few other ones are going to have... HDR support. So it's going to look like it's going to be a feature that's going to be supported by lots of games, especially with the PS4 Pro also supporting HDR. So hopefully we see it like just in PS4s in general is going to be supporting HDR supposedly. So it's going to be something we see a lot of games. Everything is going to start supporting
I'm hoping before the year's out, we'll see Halo 5. And I mean, at least just getting it announced that it's going to be patch rates are HDR, Halo 5, Killer Instinct. I don't think they'll do Motorsport 6 because Motorsport 7 is coming out. What other titles would you guys like to see that are maybe getting a little older now, but you'd still like to see the support come back? Maybe Rise of the Tomb Raider.
Yeah, Horizon 2, Rise.
Yeah.
Titanfall, yeah, Ori. That Ori's gonna look awesome in HDR.
Oh, yeah. Sunset Overdrive. That would be an awesome one. Yep. Cuphead. That's not out yet.
Well, I mean, I'd really want to see it on my TV to get HDR. But, you know, I would love to see it firsthand. I saw it at E3, but then I found out last night or a couple of nights ago that a lot of the TVs weren't HDR. So,
the lighting. I was fooled too because I'm sorry I didn't. I
know no. It's just
but when I started playing that Horizon 3 demo, I was fooled too because I thought it was an HDR for a moment because the lighting is so much better.
Yeah, it really pops.
All right, let's get to the biggest.
Go ahead, Tim. I interrupted.
No.
I'm sorry.
Pretty much. Pretty much the same thing. You know, I just want to see it. I have to get an HDR. I want to see. You know, see what it is. I was talking to somebody who was using it, and it was a guy, they have a pre-release or whatever, Forza Horizon, and they were, like, saying how good it looks. So I can't wait to actually get it and see it. But how much they could support, what would they support? I'm hoping they do as much as possible. If it's not, it doesn't seem like a huge deal to patch it in.
Yeah. No, I don't think so. It might be for some... I don't think so. I'd also like to see games that are continuing to run, like service games, like World of Tanks and Star Trek Online. Games like that starting to support it. But
you mean Star Trek?
Star Trek. No, Star Trek.
Well, two things with this. Like, one thing is, I can't wait to play Battlefield 1 and sweet 720p HDR. It's gonna be awesome.
1080p quality.
Yes.
1080p quality.
1080p quality.
It's 1080p quality. It's
yeah. And the second thing is, when is Capcom going to give us any love for Resident Evil 7 demos? Because it seems like they're just catering to the PS4 audience, and I want to actually play this game on a Xbox One.
We're getting Resident Evil. I don't know. Well, you got to remember, a thing Sony does is they pay for exclusive announcement rights. So
bastards.
They've done it time and time again. Yeah. They did it with The Witness. Because with The Witness, for a long time, he was not allowed to say it was coming to Xbox One. For a very long time.
Foiled again, Jason.
And by the way, I want to see Dead Rising 4 announced to have HDR, damn it. I think Dead Rising would be a game with all the dark settings and you got the, you know, the fireworks and all that. That's a game that would get a shit ton out of HDR.
Oh, hell yeah.
Yeah, I'd love to see that too.
Yeah, lots of games, especially, you know, all the colorful stuff like you know, the Borderlands is gonna. Well, that's kind of old.
So oh, Borderlands would look amazing in HDR.
Yeah,
the art style. Yeah,
yeah. We'll see. We'll see. Hopefully, it'll be. I mean, it's good that Microsoft is kind of doing it a little, moving it. You know, rolling it out little by little. So hopefully, we'll get the support, like you said, with the little patches and all that stuff. Especially with Halo 5. That I can't wait to see that in HDR. That's gonna be awesome.
Yeah. All right.
Let's move on to the biggest news of the week. I think it's the biggest news. Battlefield 1 open beta had 13.2 million unique players. Like, that is fucking huge for a Battlefield game. I think this is the biggest Battlefield has ever been in any situation. Like, that's insane the amount of people they got.
You mean, this game. You're telling me that if a company listens to their customers and that they want something new and different, that customers will actually respond by playing it and supporting it?
Maybe. It's crazy, right? It's crazy.
It's hilarious.
But they had 13.2 million uniques. They had 28.9 million melee kills. 13 million kills scored by the armor train. So we know everybody that played at least got killed. Most people, almost everybody that played got killed at least probably once by the fucking train.
So Dustin, you're saying we all got, you know...
Bamboozled, yeah.
No, we all got the train ran over us.
Yeah, the train came and went all over you. 62.2 million kills while on a horse. Because I'm on a horse. Yeah, I mean, this was probably the most successful beta they've ever done in a period, I think. Mm-hmm. Like, EA had killed it with this beta. And you don't see that often nowadays. Like EA has been, they've been really stepping it up. Like, I mean, I'm really happy to see Battlefield 1 doing so well. And I'm really hoping that this is the kind of turning point where Battlefield starts leading the shooter franchise when it comes to these types of shooters.
Yeah, it's incredibly impressive. It leads me to think that it'll have really successful numbers. And it'll be interesting to see how it fares against Call of Duty. You know, it's probably one of their few times where their Battlefield stuff has been going on the ups, you know, upswing, I guess.
Yeah. See, it definitely seems like it's gotten a little push this year compared to previous years.
You got to give them credit, though, because they went from Battlefield 4, which was modern whatever, and then they went to Hardline, which they could have done futuristic combat, but they didn't. They did urban cop versus robber, and now they're doing Battlefield 1. They haven't really followed the, you know, the let's do modern combat and just that, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like that they've been like changing it up a little bit here and there. I never really liked Hardline. It's unfortunate that kind of I felt like it went by the wayside because all the hate for like the whole you know, the way it was renamed. I don't know if it was actually renamed. Maybe it was a different game, and who knows. But I really liked the campaign. I thought it was really cool. I played some of the multiplayer for that one. It was decent. I mean, you definitely need a lot more people to play with on your team. But oh man, why you gotta do that to me, man? Well, I guess I'll just move on then. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, we can still talk about Battlefield. All we want. We'll talk about Battlefield.
That was a mistake. I see these things that are, I just went out to Beam. I didn't know that I was going to do that. Now I understand what you guys are talking about.
No, it's okay, Tim. You guys can go ahead. I'm just going to shoot myself in the head.
Hey.
Stop.
Oh, my God. Now people
Mr. Z is here.
Oh, Z. What's up, man?
Look, you're getting cheers now.
Yeah, you're getting cheers.
Thanks for stopping by, guys.
You know what? I'm going to give you a cheer.
Just no cause... audio. What do you mean no audio? Nobody else has complained about no audio.
Yes.
Oh, it was disabled on my browser. My bad. Okay, I was about to say that shit. And we've been broadcasting this whole time with no audio. What's going on?
Oh, that'll be a nightmare.
All right. Well, I guess we're going to move on from Battlefield.
How about Ark Survival news? Made the game look better. It runs way better.
It does, huh?
It runs so much better. Yeah,
does it look better, or is it kind of the same?
Well, you know, whenever you load it in that game, like, especially if you logged out and you're inside of a... Boo. Okay. And you logged out inside of the building, and you spawned back in, and your character would, like, spawn under the building because it would take too long to load the structure. Yeah. It doesn't do that anymore. It loads it quickly enough to where you spawn in the building and you don't really deal with that. You don't really get the lag associated with being around large structures anymore in the game, because the game is actually using the Xbox's ES RAM now for that stuff. So it just gives it a much more smoother experience. It gets rid of some of the tearing, and they did lower the resolution scaling at I guess you could say they raised the resolution scaling, however the hell you want to mm-hmm. say it, at a distance, so it actually looks better now.
Oh, nice.
Good.
Yeah, I'm glad this game is still getting all that good support, especially graphically, because when I first started playing, it was a lot of tearing. I know it's a new engine, it's the Unreal Engine 4, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, of course, there's growing pains with that type of stuff, but... Yeah, it's awesome. It's getting so much support, and everybody's supporting it. I can't wait to play it when it's finally out. I mean, I know, you could try it on the
that game is going to be extremely extensive when it launches. Like that,
it's going to sell. I mean, it sold already 1.5 million on Xbox, so that's just to show you how big it is.
I kind of wish a company like Microsoft would buy them out and build a campaign for that game, like put some real money into it. I would love to see an actual campaign to that game.
Yeah, I was just going to say that. It's interesting that you say that. I was going to say, why? I'm surprised Microsoft hasn't like snapped them up for like some...
They should, man.
Deal. Yeah.
They really should. I don't think this is like the next Minecraft, but it's going to fucking sell.
Oh, yeah. It's already has sold.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What, isn't it still the number one selling thing on Xbox Live, digital?
Well, yeah, or did well,
something
I...
else take that?
I know it's 1.5 million, so that's really a high number.
Yeah. It was impressive. The fastest selling at a certain time. I don't know if it's the most selling, just the fastest.
It might be the most selling on the not compared to like Halo or anything independent.
For independent,
sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it might be.
And then now we have everyone yelling, "But Witcher 3, look, Witcher 3 is a special case, all right?" Witcher 3 is the independent studio of Bill Gates or whatever. That's a rich ass independent studio.
Yeah. I feel like these guys need at least like kind of like one more little push. I mean, not little, but like a little bit more of a financial push, maybe to kind of get them out of, you know, get the stuff out the door. Maybe they kind of need a little bit more more support from maybe Microsoft. Who knows? Maybe another third party developer. But yeah, I feel like just need just a little bit more just to hit, you know, get the stuff out.
Dear God, don't let it be Activision.
Or
Deep Silver. EA wouldn't be a bad fit for Ark.
Oh, yeah. That'd be cool.
But I would mostly want to see Microsoft take it.
Well, it was actually a Microsoft employee who left Microsoft.
Yeah.
So I don't know if he wants to be brought back.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, he was working with a different company before that, because that's why he got in trouble making this game. Because he went and made the studio after he signed a contract saying he wouldn't work for another game studio for like a year or something like that. Which I think is bullshit. I think those contracts should be null and void straight up. You shouldn't be able to sign a contract saying you can't work in the industry for a year just because someone hired you. But we'll get to the Sue Hay stuff later after we get through the news. Someone brought it up in the chat room.
Yeah.
All right, let's do some emails, guys. I think it's time for emails.
I can't see him because my video is still not working. I guess I'll bring it up on Mozilla.
Damn it. Good day, Uncut crew. Been a while since I've written a letter, so apologies. Wait,
is this, excuse me, is this good day as in like Australian good day? Or?
It is G-D-A-Y, good day.
Okay.
I'll say it qualifies.
I'll go with Australian.
We'll go Australian.
Good day, Uncut crew. Been a while since I've written a letter, so apologies. Now that Sony has shown their limited hand, I feel like this is a great opportunity for Microsoft to capitalize, assess the market over the next year, and really set their platform up for the next decade. I believe that while Microsoft have come out with a couple of numbers for the specs of Scorpio, I have a feeling that the final box will be a fair amount more powerful. I suspect that Microsoft's intentions are to have the Scorpio be the base model Xbox for at least a decade, and its architecture is what will be irritating Sony. Iterated from going forward. This would allow them to continue to sell a really powerful box well into the future as an entry point for all gamers well into the future, bringing them into the ecosystem safe in the knowledge that their game library will follow them around forever. Having said all that, the only part of this box we almost know is locked is the GPU that will almost certainly be based on AMD's RX 480. Given my theory above, I'd have to guess that the CPU will be based on Zen, and if they really do intend to make this the base model for a decade, I suspect they may take the plunge and go with a new high bandwidth memory for the RAM setup. I reckon they'll be prepared to take the hit for the initial year or two, knowing they'll be making a tidy profit on all future boxes for a decade. What do you guys think? Special Ed. Feel free to pronounce it Special Ed.
Special Ed. I think it's a good theory, but will it really happen? I don't know. I think that they look at this console as a refresh, so they have to keep compatibility in mind. And I do think that they can't have too much of a gap between Scorpio and Xbox One because these games have to be compatible. There was a report that said Zen's not going to be semi-custom until 2018, which rules out Zen. But then some of that report, well, the author was questioned. Some of the things didn't add up. Some of the things he said contradicted it. We had tried to contact, I know Mr. Z did, and even I think I wrote something to the author. He had no answer. So it's quite up in the air. I do think that they are gunning for a 4K spec that they can pretty much run all Xbox One games. Aside from, obviously, the 60 frames per second ones, like Battlefield maybe won't make the cut. But you're talking about a majority of 80% of the Xbox games will be 4K up native, not upscale. And I think that was, that's the reason why they didn't wait for this year. They thought this year was a half step, and that's why they waited for next year.
And you know what, Tim? Let's explain. Before we can talk about what Scorpio does, let's explain what Pro does, because I think there's some confusion there, because people, especially with Sony going 4K quality at upscaling, but what the PS4 Pro does is it uses a method called checkerboarding, where it basically renders two 1080p renders of the screen of what it's trying to display, which is actually more pixels than 2K, which is why it looks better than 2K. I don't know if it's necessarily the checkerboard technique that they're using that makes it look better, or if it's just the fact that it has more pixels to work with, which is probably just that. But basically what it means is it's half the pixels of 4K, and most of the games are probably going to be stuck around there. It's quite literally half the pixels. So on Scorpio, even if you have games that don't quite hit 4K, even if they're, let's say, instead of being 2160p, they're 1900p, or, I don't know, 2000p, that's still way more than pixels than actually what the PS4 Pro is doing. So it's still going to look better. I don't think every game's going to hit 4K, but those that do are going to look great, and those that don't are still going to look better than what you're going to get on PS4 Pro. It's all about the amount of actual pixels you have to work with upscaling. Mm-hmm. And it's funny that, isn't it funny how the topic of upscaling became so big this generation when the 360 generation, like almost every giant game upscaled, and almost every giant game didn't run at 720p native, not until the end of the generation.
Yeah. Well, you couldn't call. Like,
Call of Duty ran at what, 640p?
Yeah, something like that. So did Halo.
Yep, Darksiders as well. That was sub, air quotes, sub 720p.
But with the Scorpio, as far as the Scorpio goes, whether or not it's Zen, I don't know. But I think people get a little too focused on just Zen. All I know is it's not going to be Jaguar. And that's really all that matters. If it's Jaguar, Jesus. But as long as it's not Jaguar, I think we'll all be happy. And I don't see it being Jaguar, considering by the time this thing launches, Jaguar will be a four-year-old chipset. Not to mention, honestly, I see a lot of people posting out $500 to $700 numbers. My bet is this thing's going to be $399 max.
Well, could they get the 4K spec with Jaguar?
What, a $399?
Oh, no. I mean, here's the thing.
Could hit the 4K spec
with Jaguar? Yes. But it's not going to cost... You don't have to use Jaguar to make it $400, though. I think that's what people are losing. They're not seeing. You don't... By the time this thing comes out, Jaguar will be extremely inexpensive. It's not going to be a powerful chip. It wasn't a powerful chipset when it came out. By the time Scorpio comes out, they're probably going to be able to put a much more powerful CPU and keep it around $399.
And if you're looking to kind of future-proof your system, it's not the CPU you'd want to put in it.
And let's not forget, by the time Scorpio comes out, Jaguar chips will be powering the new VTech toys for little kids. So let's not forget that either.
yeah, so basically... The Scorpio, like, if we were going to build one, I mean, it would be 12 gigabyte of RAM. I mean, it doesn't really matter what we think, though. I think all the speculation is kind of silly. I mean, just wait till next E3 and you'll find out. Like, I also agree that 6 teraflops is the minimum, and it's probably going to be higher. But I kind of think this endless speculation and Zen or not Zen or this or that, I think it really doesn't matter until we actually find out. I know that sounds a little rude, but that's the way I kind of feel about it.
Yeah, I feel like the spec speculating is it's not quite that interesting for me anymore. I'm kind of like from what I've heard lately is that just speaking about that, I heard the Zen architecture wasn't really being considered. Might be something some alternate type of architecture, but yeah, I mean the specs are cool. I mean they're interesting for a little while, but I'm more interested in what they have what they have planned overall. Like they have their whole ecosystem set up for future generations and stuff like that. And I feel like they have all the pieces in place for just the Xbox gamer to enjoy their stuff and not have to worry about backwards and forward. I mean, because the stuff's all taken care of. So I'm really interested in seeing what the whole plan is moving forward from the Scorpio onwards. I'm actually also more interested in seeing what type of games they have planned ahead that we don't know about. And also, because we know about certain games like State of Decay and stuff like that, but E3 that showed that we've seen last time wasn't that feature. It wasn't looking towards the future that much compared to past E3s. It was very much for this year and stuff like that. So I'm really interested in what they have planned for the future. I know we have Scalebound, we have State of Decay, like we mentioned, and what else is coming out that we know of? Crackdown 3, right?
Crackdown 3.
State of Decay 2.
State of Decay 2.
Forza Motorsport 7.
Right.
Which is a given, but... honestly, I'm really happy they did what they did at last E3. I know a lot of people, especially Steve and Vern, were very unhappy that they didn't show, like, that they bought new developers or announced games that were far off or any of that. I'm really happy that at E3 they focused on what was coming now to next E3. Instead of, here's a game coming out in 2 years that we don't even have a release date for.
Yeah, I feel like that worked out in their favor as far as, you know, the current day thing. So I think it's working out for them in that end. Like I said, it's going to be, because they haven't revealed, like I said, it hasn't revealed a whole lot of what the future is going to be with the Xbox and the Scorpio. So that's one of the most interesting things that is coming to my mind as far as just what's to come with the whole brand and everything and what they're heading towards.
Right.
So.
All right. Thanks so much, Special Ed, for writing in.
We're gonna move thanks, on man. To
the next letter.
Thanks for writing in.
Andrew writes in, says, "Hi, fellas. I've been looking forward to Recore since last year's E3 reveal, and I'm pleasantly surprised by all the post-launch positive impressions of the game has garnished, despite its shortcomings on the technical side, dragging down the Metacritic numbers. This got me thinking a lot about the fact that at this point, Microsoft has 5 notable games this gen that have been new IPs for Xbox. Rise, Ori, Sunset Overdrive, Quantum Break, and Recore, which have been declared dead as franchises to either poor sales or IP not belonging to Microsoft. My question in regards to this are, 1, at what point should Microsoft stop focusing on new IPs and start looking back at these titles to see which have struck accord with the people who played it in order to begin the process of getting the sequel made. 2, if Microsoft were to take a retrospective look at these new IPs launching during this gen, which ones do you believe deserve another game? For me personally, Rise and Recore are both games thoroughly enjoyed by a large number who have played them and are great genre that Xbox currently doesn't have. Action adventure, Nintendo-esque platformer. What do you guys think about this, or do you think Microsoft should keep churning out new IPs at this pace until one of them is a hit right out of the gate? Thanks for taking my question, Andrew.
I think you kind of answered your own question when you asked, so do you look at which one struck a curve or struck a chord and saying that they're not being focused on for new IPs because of lack of sales? If they're not being focused on for new IPs from lack of sales, that means they didn't strike a chord. I mean, that's really the honest thing here. Sunset Overdrive, honestly, well, one, they don't own the IP, so they have no reason to invest their own money into building the IP up, which I know some people are kind of like, well, that's just vain, that's stupid. Well, yeah, but you got to think of it from Microsoft's side of it. What do they get out of making that IP big? They don't really get anything out of it, especially considering the IP doesn't sell very much. Quantum Break, they own the IP. I don't know what to say about Remedy and the whole thing, man. Remedy, they're going into multiplayer stuff now, right?
Yeah, they're going multiplayer, multi-plat.
I don't even think Remedy would want to work on another Quantum Break if they asked them. Ori's getting another game, so Ori and the Blind Forest 2 is coming. Rise, Son of Rome, no one bought the IP, not to mention the studio that owned the IP is gone, and the people that bought the IP are not using it. As far as Recore goes, I mean, this would really be one for Vern. Vern would go on for a while about this. Vern would tell you that they really needed to delay this game, give it time to be made, more budget, more people. Although I think you could say that about a lot of games, but I personally have not played it. But that's just what you get with these niche titles, man. I honestly would just I would rather them continue to make new IPs and give new IPs a chance than make a sequel to a game that a lot of people didn't like. I mean, am I alone in that opinion?
Yes.
Okay.
Well,
it's good to know.
looking at these, let's see. Okay, so Rise, that seemed to have done well. It was a launch title, so I think that kind of, and a lot of people like the game despite what people may say about the whole repetitive aspect of it. I mean, it's a beat 'em up, to be, you know, to be honest. But I think that was a financial success from what I've seen. The only unfortunate thing, like Jason said, is it's a IP that's in limbo because Crytek is just not. They're kind of in hide mode right now because you don't really know what the heck they're doing. Ori, that was a success, I would say. I mean, that's yeah, financially it did well. It's on three different platforms, so or is it two? I'm sorry. Yeah, it's on Steam. Is it on the Xbox One?
360. It's on 360, I believe, or what's supposed to be.
No, I don't think it hit the 360. They had plans for it, but yeah, but it was Steam, Xbox One, and I think it's on Windows Store. I'm not 100% sure on that one. I might be wrong. But that one did well. That's one for one, Microsoft. Sunset Overdrive didn't do so well, unfortunately. Great game. I love the game. It's one of my favorite new IPs. That's kind of their call for Insomniac's call in regards to this game. Maybe they can do another game with Microsoft. I kind of doubt it, but I really hope so. Quantum Break, that's a weird one. I was hoping for Remedy to make another one. I'm pretty sure they would do another one if they were given the chance to. And what's weird was that I always wanted Remedy to break up into two teams so they can do, work on multiple projects instead of just doing one long project, what they usually do. And unfortunately it happened, but with this case is they're not doing anything with Quantum Break, so it's like you win some, lose some on this one. Recore, it's too early to say. I would agree with Vern in regards to just it should get a little bit more polished for the year. It would need at least another year or so, I think, as far as just polish goes. But I love the game. I really enjoy it. So I mean they're batting decently. I really wish certain ones came back. I hope they keep continuing to invest in new IPs. That's really what's important to them. And I hope they actually try to do more with them, even if they're not, considered successful. Because if you're not going to take care of your own IP, who will? You got to do something with it, even if it doesn't hit that, sales mark. I mean, try again. Sony has done it multiple times with Ratchet & Clank. Mm-hmm. That was kind of like they burned everyone with that one. Because there were like multiple Ratchet and Clank games, and so you gotta just keep trying, man. Like you gotta keep going. Don't just give up because it didn't sell, like 100 like million units, whatever. It's just that's the thing with Microsoft that kind of frustrates me, is that they want to get their own IP, but they don't support it fully. They kind of go half, halvesies with it sometimes. If it's not Halo, Gears, or Forza, which are really great IPs that are excellently supported throughout the whole year. You always got something to play. Always have some great multiplayer with those games. So that's my only issue with Microsoft in regards to their new IPs. But yeah, just keep trying, man. You gotta keep bringing them out. You gotta show these people. You gotta condition them not to just rely on the same games. And there are also definitely single player games to play. Yeah.
Oh, one correction. Oh. Crytek is not. They didn't sell off their stuff. I was thinking about THQ. But Crytek did pretty much stop developing games altogether. I don't agree with you very much on the idea that what were you bringing up with? It's one thing to go, okay, cool, this game didn't perform well or perform completely like shit, but that doesn't mean we shouldn't give it a second try. I got that, but it feels like it's kind of like a, I don't know. For me, that feels, I would rather them try a new IP and give another IP a chance, especially in the case of Sunset Overdrive, where they don't even own the IP at all. I mean, they get nothing at making this IP a big IP that could go on to be on the Sony on PS4. That doesn't do them any good.
Yeah, I mean, it really doesn't. Yeah, I don't disagree with you there. I just think that I mean, you don't even have to do it right away. Just maybe a few years down the line, maybe like, oh, hey, these guys like this game. Let's try maybe one more time. It's the same situation they're in with the Rare IPs. Like, they don't use them at all, but they've had long time to figure out what to do with them, and they still haven't done anything with them.
No, I would rather them use the IPs. They have a lot of great IPs they already own that they're not using.
That's true, too.
Well, yeah, but we're talking about, I mean, the main topic is new IPs and whether they should keep supporting them. But it's like they already have IPs that have done better than the new IPs are trying, and they're not even messing with them. Like Crimson Skies game at like $20 bucks would be fucking insane.
I think we're right now we're shut out as far as the IP and seeing another IP aside from Ori, but I'm not counting Ori because Ori's not a AAA title. So the IPs that we've seen this generation, pretty much, I don't see us getting a sequel. ReCore has the most potential, in my opinion, for a sequel because they could fix a lot of the problems that the first one had, which is performance. They go to Unreal Engine. They can make it a AAA. I really enjoyed the game. I was enjoying the game, so it might be a little bit too early. But the other IP that might actually catch or, be the IP that takes off is, what's the next IP, the new IP that's coming? It's escaping.
Scalebound.
Scalebound. There's another IP. Sea of Thieves is going to be the IP that I believe will gain traction. So I don't think Scalebound will. I don't think that this is the, I think Scalebound is going to be a game that caters to the base. I think it'll do okay. But Sea of Thieves, I do feel, will be the IP that, gains traction and that, we build on it.
Yeah, I'm actually more excited for the stuff coming rather than the idea of, like, a Sunset Overdrive 2. I'm more excited for State of Decay 2. I'm more excited for Crackdown. I'm more excited for Scalebound. I would rather all these other new IPs get that money and get a try at the turn rather than make another game that could just be as bad as the first one or just be another failure. I mean, I hate to call Sunset Overdrive a failure because I really like the game, but it's not like building a game, because I think their Spider-Man game is probably going to be extremely successful, but I mean, I guess that's one of the things that comes with starting a new IP. And the great thing is they own the IP, so we might get a Sunset Overdrive 2 at some point, just not for a while. Especially not till after they're done with Spider-Man.
Yeah, ideally, yes, I would like both new IPs and revivals. I mean, we've also seen revivals that have been successful, like Killer Instinct. That's a rousing success in my view. And so,
I want to see them use Conquer, Mech Assault. Like, they have so many good IPs.
Mm-hmm. Mech Assault would be great.
Mech Assault would be fantastic.
It's a cloud.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Andrew, for writing in. I hope we answered your question.
Yeah, excellent questions.
Yes. Well, multiple questions, will be answered.
Yes.
All right, let's talk about Karn. Karn wrote in. He says, "Hey, guys. I know there have been many conversations on 4K TVs in the past few podcasts, but I was curious as to what TV brands you guys prefer, or does it usually just come to specs? Have any of you guys thought about possibly getting the NES Mini Classic? I know you can play these games with an emulator, but I'm still getting it for the nostalgia factor. Also, any news on rumors about when the heck the NX is?
Exactly. What the heck it is?
Who knows? I know this is an Xbox podcast, but still had to ask for my final question. Do any of you have interest in the Mafia 3 game coming out for Xbox One in October, or will Gears 4 remove the interest or any other possible gaming release that month? Thanks for taking the time and reading my email. I may not write in often, but I definitely never miss a podcast. Keep up the great work as per usual.
Karn." Thank you, Karn.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks, Karn.
Very nice email.
Now, I am, just to throw it out there right now, I'm totally committed to Mafia 3. Like, that game looks fucking fantastic. Like, just the idea of what they're doing to that world is very interesting. Like, I want to see exactly how they approach all the philosophical issues in that time. Like, how, you know, we you don't see a game try to tackle race or real human issues. Like there's all kinds of stuff in there, and they're going to be toying with it, and it's definitely a universe I am prepared to get into and like entrenched in. Now Gears 4, I'm going to play a lot of Horde mode. I won't lie, Horde mode's coming. It's going to be amazing. But I can't wait for Mafia 3. Like, I'm really excited for just a really drawn out, amazing story. And it should be a fun game. Like, it's going to be open world, you know, that whole, you'll get to enjoy all that. But I'm fully committed to having a story like that.
I get the same feeling about that game as I do Dead Rising 4. It's not that I think it's going to be the best game of the year or game, like, you know, it's going to win all these awards or some bullshit or have this insane Metacritic score. It's just that I you can see the potential for the fun in the game, or just, especially with Mafia 3, the way, like you said, they're tackling topics in it. Like, you're going to see the KKK in the game. Like, they're not holding back on racial slurs or anything. I think that's awesome. I guess we'd start off with the 4K thing. As far as 4K TVs go, brand does matter, but it doesn't, as of right now, brand doesn't matter as much as specs matter, definitely. In the future, maybe a year from now, brand might matter a little more to you than specs, but right now, if you're buying a 4K TV, what really matters is whether or not it has proper UHD colors, the latency with HDR on. There's a lot of small different things, and it would take a while to go over everything, but it's definitely about the specs as far as TVs right now for 4K.
Yeah, I feel like
Go ahead, Will. I'll go after you.
No worries. I mean, I feel like it's still kind of early. I haven't really looked into the 4K stuff. I'm okay with my 1080p TV. I have Samsung. But I feel like it's still early, like, to really gauge which is the best. I would say just hold off maybe a year, half a year, you know, half a year into it to see which are maybe rated the best, maybe a Consumer Reports type of thing. And maybe keep checking, you know, maybe the gaming, networks and see what they have. You know, it's a preferred gaming TV. So, I mean, I don't have anything that's capable of 4K, so I'm not really in that particular conversation yet. But, yeah, I would say just wait a little bit and see, you know, from what the impressions are for the upcoming TVs. Although I hear Vizio is getting up there in excellent quality.
Yeah, Vizio's giving you a really good bang for your buck, and they're giving you very low latency. I mean, I personally really like the aesthetics of most Samsung TVs, honestly. I like the look, their style, and
their quality, too.
Samsung's usually pretty good quality, and they're going to have great HDR TVs in the future. Now, like, if you're trying to buy one today, we've said it over and over again, the Vizio 50-inch is the way to go. It's about $700-$800 in that price range right now. It's going to look gorgeous. The P series, by the way, not the other series.
The M series is the other
one.
Yeah,
the M series is the one you want to stay away from, if you can. Now
it has, Dolby Vision and HDR10 support.
Yeah. Now, it's something that you, like, the support is, like, really being fine-tuned right now, and people are updating their TVs to support it. That's why I honestly think next year is going to be the year, like, after CGS and all that stuff, next year is going to be the year you're going to get a great TV. And that's going to be the year you're going to, like, HDR is going to be everywhere, and you're not going to be sitting there like, oh, does this 4K support it? Which version does it support? It only supports HDR10. What about Dolby Vision? What about that? Like, you're going to get over that hump by next year. It's just this year, it's really early, and it's kind of, you know, the decision to go with that kind of TV, I'd wait. Honestly, I'd really wait until there's actually everything's kind of ironed out. I think that's the best solution for most people. Now, there's some really good TVs out there right now. I think the Vizio P series is good TV. You can watch some great content. But next year is going to be the real year. Like, right when Scorpio is about to launch, that's when 4K TVs are going to really shine. And we're going to see a lot of different, you know, a lot of different companies, a lot of different settings that you're going to be able to choose from. But everything will be there, and the standards will be set. So you won't have to sit there and worry about, will I get the software update that allows me to do HDR10 or Adobe Vision? Like, you don't have to worry about that no more. It'll just be supported.
Well, I mean, for me, you're going to see 4K TVs really affordable this holiday. So you could definitely check. The website I recommend you check is www.rtings.com/ting, so that's R's and Ricky, tings, tings.com. It gives you ratings, it gives you the rundown of 4Ks, it gives you the latency, it gives you everything that you need to know. Now, right now, I highly recommend, they're more expensive, but they you could find good deals, and this year, you might start to see them come into an affordable range. Definitely next year, as Dustin talks about, a lot of the TVs and the standards will be set. But the OLEDs, it's a different experience, in my opinion, than visually versus the LED. Now, Samsung and LG are pretty much right now, for me, running... running against each other is the top quality. I think LG, now I'm talking about media too. Some people, if it has a decent input lag and it could play games, but it's not great, but it has a great, a picture and stuff like that, I'd still look into those TVs. I don't disregard for the gamer. The Vizio is definitely a series that you have to look at, because they're supporting everything, and they have good input ratio, and the lag is good. But I right now my TV is my manufacturer, the top is LG. Mm-hmm. I feel with their OLED brand or that line of TV is second to none. Now Samsung is very close. They have quantum dot technology, so that's very good too. Sony is also a player, Vizio. But again, a lot of this is customer research. You have to do your research. Artings is a great place to research. Read a couple of these tech sites to find the model that you want. If you're going to go into Best Buy, do not let the guy tell you anything, because those people just want to sell you the TVs. Have your phone ready. Just ask them for the model number. Search the model number. Look at the specs. Look at the price points. Look at where it's falling. Look at the reviews. And you can buy a TV. And the TVs, right now, they're going to, this holiday, like I said, the affordability is going to be there. For 4K LEDs, OLEDs probably come down a little, but in 2017, as Dustin was alluding to, is like, it's going to be euphoria for TV. It's going to be the time to, like, especially holiday 2017. You're going to be able to get OLEDs for $1,500-$1,600. You're going to be able to get LEDs for, 4Ks for $500, $400. The models that they're coming out with now are good, so you could also get those models next year at a really discounted rate. So the answer is, if you're in the field, in my opinion, if you're looking at TVs, wait till Black Friday, till the holiday this year. If you can hold off, and if 2017, the more you wait, the better TV you're going to get, probably. Yeah. For the money too,
Definitely.
Okay, now the NES Mini Classic. I'm not getting one because I looked at the games. I mean, they got good games up there. I'm not saying it's bad. I just, like, to me, SNES was the best gen. If it was a SNES Mini Classic, I would have bought that in fucking a split second. But the NES Mini Classic, I know not Jason, but my other brother's buying one. Like, everybody's excited to get them. I don't know. Like, it's a cool concept, but I'd rather play SNES games. It's just where I'm at.
I think it's dumb that it doesn't play actual NES games, and that's where my interest really just stops for it. It's like, I don't really get that. Like, why doesn't it? Why can't they just add a port so it can actually, you know, play NES titles? Because it's cool that it comes with 60-whatever preloaded titles. But you got, especially got a lot of collectors out there that, you know, I guess they wouldn't mind having a new box that could play the games. Especially considering when did they stop producing Nintendos? But, I don't know. I would also like to have at least seen maybe an online system for the device to where you could get more games. I just feel like it's kind of a limited device. It feels kind of like those devices you buy at the store for your kids that have the 100 games pre-installed on it. But, you know, it's Nintendo, so it's got better games.
Yeah, it's a cool niche little nostalgia box. I guess basically to travel with in case you want to carry around your Xbox One. God knows that thing will kill somebody, and then or PS4. But yeah, it's a cool concept. I'm not personally interested. Like, a lot of the games have been kind of scattered around in collections, like Mega Man and Castlevania and stuff like that. So I mean, I'm sure you can find a good range of them already on your current console, if not the previous one. Especially also have like Capcom Classics and stuff like that. I prefer to just play them on my native console. So that's just me. But I don't know, maybe this will appeal to me one day. I mean, and like Dustin said, SNES, forget about it. That'd be awesome. I can definitely get down with that one.
Yeah, I would. You hear SNES and it'd just be like fucking... I don't think they could make enough, period. I think that'd be the next 200 million selling console would be a SNES version just of this.
The funny thing is, they could make that thing like 20... They could make that thing $10. I mean, honestly, with the hardware... I mean, it's nothing.
There's not much to it. Yeah.
Oh, I'm sure they're making a ton of money off this NES box.
Oh no, that's they're gonna make.
And I'm interested in it. It's a great Christmas present. I'll tell you that much.
Yeah. That's what it is. It's a great Christmas present. That's what it is. I honestly kind of see emulators still being way better option, and you can do it legally. but. I think for the more casual person, it's going to be awesome.
Yeah, it's definitely a good stocking stuffer for that type of thing. And in another way, also, since Nintendo is kind of inept with their emulation as far as their virtual console stuff, this may actually be a better option for you. You know, this might be better for especially, you know, if you do an SNES version. I can't wait to play like Dr. Mario, Tetris. That's a great game. That type of stuff would be awesome if they did that. So that'd be an awesome alternative to Nintendo's kind of iffy backwards compatible catalog.
Yeah. But just to clarify, Jason said 60 games earlier. It's 30 games. 30.
Oh, I thought it was 60.
It's 30 games.
That's even worse.
Oh, forget it. Just burn it. Burn it. Forget it. Just burn it.
It's 30 games.
Well, that's why I have a problem with it. It must have been that because. It's not that many games.
Super Mario Brothers, Donkey Kong, Metroid.
Yeah, but imagine if they just added a
cell.
Imagine if they took a 10-cent little port and put it on it, and you could put your game in it and play it. I mean, all it has to do is read the cartridge.
I know. But I mean, like I said, I want SNES. All right. So what do y'all think of the NX? What the heck is it? What are the rumors? So it's a handheld.
It's a more powerful 3DS that can hook up to your TV.
Yeah, mobile.
Yeah, mobile's the future.
Tegra
2 or whatever.
Tegra 1. It's probably, if it's a Tegra 2, that'd be good, but it's Tegra 1 probably.
I think they'll push some hardware muscle. Go with the Tegra 2.
If they can't, this thing needs to be more powerful than a Wii U handheld. But it's going to be hard to, I don't know. It needs to be more powerful than a Wii U. Because remember, this is going to be their TV console. That's what people are kind of skipping on the idea of this. This is literally what they're going to sell you to hook up to your TV to play games on. And if they can't make games that even look any good, or better than at least, or as good or better than Wii U, then I mean, what's the point other than, you know, it being handheld?
Yeah, I don't know. I'm like, I don't even want to speculate anymore with this thing because you see so many speculation sheets and like drawings on NeoGAF and like, I just want to see it finally. I just don't really care about any more like mock-ups or anything because it's such an interesting. Oh, thank you. It's an interesting concept, you know. It's almost kind of going with what they're doing now with the Pokemon Go app, where it's like you play as you go, and you could game at home also. So it's a cool idea. I can't wait to see it. It's going to be interesting to see what Nintendo does. Although the no backwards compatibility thing does make the Wii U a little bit more enticing, and I will be very interested to see what they do with these Zelda games as far as to see which one, you know, how the new one holds up back, you know, with the Wii U version, because we still don't know how it's going to run, really.
I have a question. We know the NX is replacing the Wii U, right? Is the NX also replacing the... Is there going to be another 3DS? Like, is this replacing both?
That would be cool.
Or are they going to have two handhelds? Are they going to have, like, a beefy handheld that's probably more expensive than NX? And then a smaller one that's just a DS? Or, like, what are they thinking here?
I think it would be smart to integrate, like, let's say people's account to access their back catalog, like their virtual console stuff.
So you can play Nintendo, man. I wish.
Yeah,
I know you can transfer on Nintendo, but they... Why can't they just come out with a fucking account system that works? That tracks your digital purchases and ties them to your account?
Yeah, that's the question.
Like, right now, I have a 3DS right here. I have this retro NES 3DS. If I wanted to sell this console, I would need to buy another 3DS and transfer it. And by the way, if I were to get a new 3DS and not transfer it and load my profile, I still couldn't play the games that I bought digitally because you have to transfer it. Because if you don't transfer it, you don't get permission. And if someone got this console and loaded their account, they can't play the games either. So technically, the games are lost without both.
Yeah, you're locked to your previous console, and it's a very underdeveloped system. I really hope Nintendo gets on the ball with that, because it would really help them a lot, because you need to have a good system in place to be able to take advantage of their games, because a lot of games, unfortunately, get lost in the shuffle, because you can't play them in certain places that they can in others, so it's a real shame.
I think Pokemon Go itself is a lesson into what Nintendo... It should be a lesson to Nintendo that they're behind the times and they need to open their eyes.
Yeah.
What I mean by that is all they did was take a single IP, Pokemon, and they put it on a new device that made it easy for people to use it and access it, and it became gigantic because their IPs are still huge. It's just their platforms are so behind the times. And I don't just mean like, you know, in hardware performance. I mean like the actual platforms. They don't really make it easy, and they don't do, like, you'd think we'd have a console version of Pokemon by now. I don't know how many times I've talked about that. That would be extremely successful.
I've always wanted to see like an open world Pokemon game that would you can maybe take with you somewhere, like with the, like say the NX. I mean, that'd be awesome. But they, for whatever reasons, they just never do with what most people would want from their games, which is frustrating, very frustrating.
I think it's gonna continue biting them. It's been biting them in the ass, and I think it's gonna continue biting them in the ass till they figure it out. But the thing is they still got lots of money, so I don't think they're in the position where they really got to do anything drastic just yet.
Yeah, we'll see.
If the NX fails horribly, they will. I'll tell you that.
Yeah, forget it.
We'll see what it is. It's so early. They're so unpredictable that I think that you have to wait and see. You know, you can't. People saying it's dead or on arrival.
Dead or arrival, yeah.
Yeah, that's all just stupid.
That's why I said I hated speculation about Scorpio too, because you get in the stupid thing where people are, you know, if it's going to fit in this price range with these specs and it's going to do this and that and this.
Yeah.
It's like, why don't we wait until E3 and find out?
Well, that's what the whole thing is I don't think people wait. But, you know, as far as NX, I have my doubts, but I do not think that anybody should underestimate Nintendo. I don't think anybody should say it's dead or on arrival. Let them show what they got. It could be something that's new, refreshing. They have always seemed to have a knack for bringing something unique. So we'll see. I think it's going to be something with mobility involved. They have such strong IPs that they're never to be counted out with what they got. You can never count them out. So I would just, like I said, give it a little time. I do think it's going to be what Wall Street Journal has, you know, said, that it's going to be like a portable, a Tegra 1 chip or, you know, the type. It's hard to conceptualize. It sounds like they're going to be using cartridges instead of discs, which is interesting. We got to see how this plays in the real world and how it actually is having it in our hands. It could be very cool. So,
you know, it'd be funny. It's something they could do, Tim. It's just this wild speculation. Chips nowadays are really good at, like, having power modes. It'd be really funny if they had, like, because, you know, if they're going to have it in front of your TV where you can plug it into your TV, they're going to have a dock, you know. It only makes sense. They'll have a dock that you have, and you just place it in there to play it. I wonder if it'd be funny if they made the dock, like, this thing that hooks up to the cooling of the device and spins up and actually cools the device and lets it run at a higher clock. So it can play games at a higher clock rate on your TV. I don't know. It'd be funny to see them try to pull something like that. But I don't think we're going to see that. It's literally going to be, you're going to get what you get on either or. I think for the person coming from their Wii U to this, I think there might be reason to maybe be disappointed. But I think if you're going from a 3DS to this, I think you're going to get a huge upgrade and you're probably going to love it. Because the 3DS is really, if you've used the 3DS in a while, they're extremely underpowered devices. If they can get, even if the NX is 720p, that will be a huge upgrade for 3DS guys.
Nice.
All right. Thank you so much for writing in, Karn. We appreciate it.
Yeah. Thanks, Karn.
All right. Now, let's go to what we've been playing. It's about Suhei? Time.
Huh? Suhei?
I played, what is that game called? Diablo 3. And you know what? I could see myself getting back into that game. It's very dangerous. Just watching, like, my character do, like, he dropped, what was it? Like, 25 million in damage. Just fucking slam somebody. I was like, yep, I want to play this again. So I might get back into Diablo 3 a little bit. I know I got all these other games coming out, so I probably won't, but.
Yeah, the game is,
it's dangerous.
It's still chugging, man. The game is lots of updates. I had to get back into it. It's a great game, but so much stuff to play, man.
Now, I also played some Rainbow Six Siege the other night, and it's a lot of fun with a group of friends. The new update was kind of cool. Played through a little bit of it, I mean, but it was all right. Anybody else play a little Rainbow Six?
No.
The update released? No. They balanced out a lot of characters, like nerfed the shit out of certain people's shields, stuff like that, just to make it a little bit more fair. But I completely enjoyed myself with it.
Yeah, see, I'm waiting for that game to hit games with gold, like The Crew, because I feel like those types of games will really benefit from that, because you can kind of, in one way, Xbox gets the revenue from the live service, and as well as, like, it's a game you don't really have to really, I guess, pay for. I mean, I guess it's because it'll be part of the service, so, I mean, that'll be a cool idea, but, yeah, I don't know, I might wait for a discount on that one. Lots of multiplayer games aren't really my bag when they're like, just multiplayer focused. I think it
should have been a $40, $30 game.
Yeah,
with DLC or whatever to make extra revenue, but I think that would have been a fantastic 30, because it gives them the money to have the quality that they, that's the problem with free to play, is you're not able to get that quality, because Rainbow Six looks great, like it's a fantastic looking game, fantastic playing game, which, you know, you need that starting money to, you know, you know, guaranteed day one to really get that quality. But I don't think it should have costed $60, and I think that kind of hurt it, just like Evolve.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, Overwatch is doing well. So there is a level in which people are able to like kind of invest into that type of multiplayer game.
Yeah.
All right. What have y'all been playing? Anything in particular?
I've been playing ReCore, which I find to be a pretty fun game. It's extensive. It's pretty deep. It's pretty tough.
Yep.
I was talking to you last night, Dustin, it was frustrating, but I enjoy the game. I also played NBA 2K17, and it was pretty good. I don't think those games, these yearly updates, should be $60, though. That's way too much.
Oh, yeah. Agreed.
Should be $40. Yep. It's the same game, essentially.
Dude, yeah, Madden, if they were to get all their EA games to $30, like all their yearly EA games, because you know they're making tons of money on them. Because they're not doing much to, like you said, they're essentially the same game for most of them. They get graphical upgrades, but
yeah, like Tim and I and all of us were talking about last week. As far as the EA games, like the sports stuff, they should really be tied to the service. As far as I think, you know, for their EA Access, it should be just updated yearly. I mean, you're still getting revenue. Lots of people subscribe. I think that's a perfect model for sports games. That way you don't have to purchase the same game every year.
And you know what they could do, Will?
Yeah.
They could have EA Access Sports.
Ah.
And you pay, awesome. Let's say, I don't know, $15 a month, and you get all the new sports games when they come out.
Oh, yeah.
And maybe, you could play them a week before they come out or whatever.
That'd be awesome.
I've never understood. I think we've talked about this before with EA doing a subscription like service.
Mm-hmm.
This would be a good way of getting EA Access bigger too.
Oh, absolutely.
I think the only thing that would hold them up on that is that the fact that they can't, well, they could probably do EA Access on Sony now or the PS4, but I think they're kind of, I wonder if they're hesitant about it.
Yeah, that'd have to be more widely adopted, and it will probably be a less of a strain on their teams to keep having to, try to burn through the whole year just to get this game out for like a few updates when they can really just use the same engine, update it, update stats, players, and it'll be a lot easier for everyone, really.
Yeah.
But.
And it's funny, you look at Killer Instinct, and Killer Instinct should be the model they should be looking at, because you just look what they do. They do more for Killer Instinct than they do for the sports games every year.
Yeah, and I think a lot of fighting games should adopt that model. I think Street Fighter, to a degree, is doing a similar thing where they're offering DLC updates, and they're continually updating the game, making it fresh for new players and stuff like that. So
Injustice should do it big time. Like, Injustice should pick up that model.
Yeah, you don't
lose any fighting game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you don't lose either way. Free to play model, you get money from people who want to play the full game, pay for the full game, and then for people who want to invest, you can get the whole game. You got bells and whistles, all the characters. And either way, Killer Instinct model is excellent. I would definitely want other games to adopt it as well, if they would want to.
To be fair, DOA did adopt it.
The last one, Final Round, was it?
Yeah, they do. Don't they do free to play? Like, you can. It's not. I don't think it's to the extent of Killer Instinct, but you can play it. But you get certain free characters. I don't know if it's completely to the extent of Killer Instinct, though.
No, yeah, it's a core. It's a core game. You get 2-3 characters, and then the rest you can purchase. Yeah. But sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt him while he was.
No.
Playing those games.
No, that's fine. That's pretty much all I had to say. I've been playing that, and that's about it. I played Prominence Poker, which I talked about last week, which is a free game. It's a fun game.
Pretty addictive. Yeah. Yeah, I want to try out those poker games online. It's got to be a lot of fun. Just playing virtual poker, that's good stuff.
Yeah. But oh. I picked up Pac-Man Championship Edition 2. I haven't played it yet, but I'll definitely talk about it next week because I own the original Pac-Man Championship Edition. So,
and nice.
I'm excited to see what they've done to it, what they've added, stuff like that.
So now, would that be similar to the DX one that they released on Xbox 360? Is it very similar to that, or is it like different?
I think it is similar.
Oh. Okay, but, so there's so many Pac-Mans, man.
Yeah. Now, what I am excited for is on the next show, because it's on Friday, we should have actual Forza Horizon 3 impressions, like the full game, since we have the Ultimate Edition, so we get it releases on the 23rd for us. So
get the. You might have to delay next podcast.
Yeah, I've been playing the demo there, and oh my god, it is amazing.
Should we talk Horizon 3 for a minute? Does everyone want to?
Yeah, we should.
Everyone good? Yeah.
Yeah, and I'll get to my played games too as well after we, you know, talk about.
Yeah, that's why I said that. I didn't mean. I don't want you to. Yeah.
No problem. I mean, well, okay. So just to get the stuff I was playing out the way, a bit of Forza 6. I kind of chip away at that game little by little. It's of course, awesome game. I like to have a little variety between the motorsport and the Horizon stuff because open world is great, but sometimes I need my structured racing and sims. Yeah. Yeah, and some stuff you just can't find on Horizon. So that been playing that. More Metal Gear, grinding away. It's a fun grind, but I've kind of taken a little bit of a break from it. But excellent game, Metal Gear Defense of Pain. That is Metal Gear 5. Just bought Mad Max from the Deals with Gold sale this week, which is $16 US. Played a bit of it. It's quite good. I like the beginning of it. It's very desolate. It's kind of it's its own thing. It's very similar to Mad Max. What was the second movie? Mad Max
Road Warrior.
Road Warrior. Yeah, very similar to that story so far. That's one of my favorite Mad Max movies.
That's my favorite. Actually, I don't like the first Mad Max, which I don't know if I'm odd, but I really like... I think the second one's fucking awesome.
Yeah.
Just walk away.
Right.
Yeah, first one is very much a humble beginnings type of story.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you don't really expect it. Because I've seen Road Warrior first, and I was like... Seeing the first one, I was like, "Huh, that's weird. Everything looks so ground, like not grounded, but everything's less chaotic, and you know, because it's the beginning of the whole thing." So, Mad Max, awesome game. Definitely pick it up for $16. You can't lose. Really, it's another open world game, yes, but the license is really cool. Post-apocalyptic, which is always fun, really good game. And also, I've been playing ReCore. A lot of reviews, I think, have been off on that game. Mm-hmm. Been a little harsh. A lot of people have been talking about this game as far as just the local buzz. Played only up to a certain point, so I'm not very far into it. But I'm very curious to see what the issues are that crop up later that people have with it. But lots of fun. I really enjoy it. Excellent new IP for Microsoft. I really hope they do a sequel, which I will be interested to see where they go with it. Hopefully maybe a bigger, like a planet hopping thing, maybe like Metroid or something. But yeah, awesome game. Very charming. Graphically looks decent. You know, I wouldn't stare at the textures for too long. just pretend that, you know, they're looking that good from far away. But yeah, cool game. And of course, Horizon 3, just an amazing game. The sound quality is just so many levels above, you know, even Forza 6. It's just the crunch of the cars hitting each other, and the lighting is excellent. The colors just pop. Even though they're not HDR, I feel like they still tweak the lighting system so that everything looks...
Oh, they definitely have. Especially over Horizon 2, but even over Motorsport 6, the lighting is way better.
Oh, yeah.
And it doesn't use that dull drive club look to make it look realistic. It just... looks realistic, which honestly kind of doesn't look realistic at times because it almost has a cartoony look because it's so vibrant. But it looks... that is one fantastic looking game. It's absolutely amazing. Insane.
Yeah, I noticed the droplets effects of the, you know, when you see the rain or water just hit your windshield. It's a little closer to Drive Club's kind of insane gooey look, but not as exaggerated. They had a lot of cool graphical effects. It has all the stuff that you could want from Forza games: puddles, weather, day-night cycle, the kitchen
sinks. Engine sounds are fantastic. They must have done work on the engine sounds too, because they're better than Motorsport 6. Especially that GT350R in the demo, way better than it sounded in Motorsport 6. And unlike Horizon 2 and Horizon, where I kind of felt like the engine sounds were a bit muffled, in this game, they didn't do any of that. These things are loud.
Yeah.
I think they did that before to try to give more... how do you say it? They wanted the music to stand out more than the cars, I guess.
Yeah,
which was kind of an odd thing.
Yeah, you gotta have a nice balance, because if you have the sound effects overpower the music, then it's like it kind of loses something there, you know. So you have to have a nice balance of music and engine sounds.
Yeah, and it's really clear now. Like there's no muffling anymore, except for, I think, is the oddest complaint, especially from sim guys, is that when you're in the interior car view, it actually muffles the engine sound. It's supposed to.
Yeah.
Not to mention, let's talk, that game is, the demo's huge. Like, the driving area? Ugh. It's only like a third of the game, too. Like, the map size.
Yeah, I had to stop playing it, because I was just like, man, this is, like, because I want to go back and play the game, like, the full game with all achievements and stuff, so, like, I had to stop at a certain point, because it's like, I don't want to get, like, too, I don't want to say worked up, but I don't want to get, like, too into it, and then, like, it's like, oh, well, it's just a demo, so I got to go back to it, play the thing all over again. And,
that's how you know you did a demo right, is when you make people want to stop playing it. But not because they want to stop playing, because they want to stop playing it. It's because they want to play the full fucking game. And I really hate the idea that they don't let you continue, like, your progress. But I think that's specifically why they did it. Right. So you get out of that demo and you relaunch it and you're like, oh, I don't want to. I want my progress to be saved. It's like, it will in a week. And you buy the full game.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm curious what Tim and Dustin have to say about the demo, because... Man,
I have played it at E3. I haven't played the open world. I'm just waiting for the next game. But yeah, looks like they've delivered on a pretty high level. I think this is going to do well, this game. I think it's going to be review well. I think it's going to sell well. I think it's going to really shine too when it comes to the graphics.
I think every sale this game gets, it probably is going to deserve more. I kind of feel that way. And I've kind of felt that way about every Horizon, because they're never gigantic sellers. But I kind of feel this game is probably, even all the sales it should get, and it probably will get, I think it deserves even more. Like, this game's going to be a real fucking hit.
Yeah, I think so.
I have one thing that's going to bother me, though, is I'm really waiting for GameSpot to give this game an 8. Just waiting for it to happen. You know it's gonna happen.
Yeah, I'm predicting a 92 Metacritic. There you go, folks. 92 Metacritic.
First 90 plus for a AAA Xbox exclusive.
I think so. Yep.
Which is pretty bullshit. I mean, their Halo 5 should have been a 90 plus, but that's just me. Forza Motorsport 6 should have not been a 90 plus, but that's just me.
Yeah, it's an Xbox game, so of course they're gonna pass it over, and like, it's an excellent, you know, 6 is an excellent race sim racer. I'm hard pressed to find anything better during that year or even now that's on that level, and yet it still yearly kind of gets passed up for some reason. It doesn't get nominated for Game of the Year awards for
racing games. Don't get nominated for Game of the Year awards, man. It just don't. It doesn't. Even though I think Motorsport 6 would have been a contender last year, they don't get the I don't think I've ever seen, maybe Burnout Paradise, I think I've seen maybe some people try to go Game of the Year for that, but you don't generally see any racing game get that kind of praise.
Yeah, but get this, even during the video game awards, the Jeff Keighley stuff, it was between Forza 6 and
Rocket League 1, which was so fucking dumb.
I was like, man, the game is great, but it's not a racer. Come on.
Yeah, they're not even in the same genre. So that didn't even make sense. Oh, they both involve cars and you're driving.
right. Just the most basics of like genre thing, you know.
Yeah. Other than that, I mean, all I could tell you guys is, our listeners, if you haven't tried it yet, go play the Forza Horizon 3 demo and play it till you get to online for your own. Try out the drone mode and play around with the drone. Go take some pictures. I think you'll probably end up like I did, and you'll find yourself playing that game and stopping so many times just to look around or look at all the small details, and there's a ton of them. So
yeah. Oh, and don't forget to put Vern Sucks on your back plate.
On your license plate. Vern Sucks. With a kangaroo.
I'd appreciate it. All right. All right, guys. So any other games or news y'all want to bring up before we end the show?
Should we just bring it up just a little bit?
He's an asshole. No, not really. I mean, it's
an
nothing.
Asshole. There
really
we go.
To fucking go on.
Yeah, I've been talking about. Yeah,
it'd be funny. I just think it's. Yeah,
it's not. It's
just not worth bringing up, honestly. Yeah, I mean, it's whatever. He's an idiot.
It's not worth talking about in depth. I forgot to say, I was playing Halo 5 as well. Multiplayer. I would love to play with you guys so we can play some team deathmatch or something. I was playing my boy Hexdrop. He's a fan of the show, a fellow gamer, Hexdrop. Shout out to you, dog.
Dog. All right. Well, I think that's going to do it for this week's podcast. I appreciate everybody for tuning in. Thanks for hanging out with us this crazy week, and we will catch you later.
Bye.
Peace out, everybody.
Peace.
Good night.